عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and I am a missionary with the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. And this is a live broadcast that you are watching either on Twitter or on YouTube or on Facebook. This is a live program. This is a live broadcast where you are free to ask us any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions, and we would be more than happy to respond to your questions, especially in light of the resources available on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, which is www.alislam.org. The official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is www.alislam.org. That is where we have a vast resource. We have a lot of resources available there. We have books, we have articles, we have press releases, we have books in various formats, not just in PDF, but Apple books, we have Amazon Kindle books. We have a whole range and variety of books where you can just go and download them for free, and you can read them for your knowledge, for increasing your knowledge, for increasing your understanding of Islam, for increasing your understanding of Ahmadiyyat. This is a live broadcast where you are welcome to submit your questions. If you are on YouTube, you can submit your questions through the live chat that is open, and I would be more than happy to help you find an answer to your questions. If you are on Twitter, you can type in your questions directly into the stream. At the bottom, it would say something, and that's where you can chat with us. You can submit your question. And if you are on Facebook, you can write in the comments section, and I will be taking up questions from that section. This is a live session. This is a live broadcast. Some of you have already joined me, especially on YouTube. If you have joined us on the other platforms, it would be nice to submit your questions or say salam so that I can know that the stream is going on and it is you can view it and you can hear me okay on Facebook and Twitter as well. I see that some of you have joined from YouTube and you are already asking questions. Jazakallah for joining us. It's always a pleasure to be here, to be communicating with you and to be having these discussions and to be discussing matters of faith. This is an Ask an Imam where you can ask any question that is related to Islam, to Ahmadiyyat, to other world religions, and I would be more than happy to respond to your questions, especially in light of the resources available on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, that is www.alislam.org. That is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, www.alislam.org. All right, some of you have joined us on YouTube, some of you have joined us on Facebook, and some of you have joined us on Twitter as well. I really thank all of you who join me and who participate in these sessions. And I want to start with, I will take up your questions very soon, but I would like to start with some clarifications from my previous couple of streams. That's why I didn't choose any specific topic today, because I wanted to respond to a couple of questions that I've had recently. And one question I said I will check and confirm, and another question I might have made said something incorrectly. Just want to clarify that. So one question that I received some time ago was, or probably it was maybe yesterday or the day before, was that if an Ahmadi Muslim finds himself in a country where there is no Jamaat, what should be done with regard to Friday and Eid prayers? In both cases, you should offer your own prayer. So when it comes to Jummah prayer, you cannot offer Jummah without the Jamaat. So having a Jamaat, having a congregation for Jummah prayer is absolutely essential. And for your convenience, I looked up the reference as well. It's in Urdu. If you are able to read Urdu, you can go to Fiqh Ahmadiyya, page number 166, where this is discussed. And it is an absolute requirement of Jummah that there has to be a congregation. And if there's no one else, and if maybe your wife is there, you can offer the Jummah with your wife. But if there's no one, absolutely no one, then it is not possible to offer Jummah prayer, Friday prayer properly. So it requires that. So I mean, the least it requires is that two people have to be there for Jummah, and a single individual cannot offer Jummah. I don't recall the actual conversation I had last time when this question was asked. If it wasn't clear at that time, now I'm trying to make it as clear as possible. It's in Fiqh Ahmadiyya, page number 166, if you would like to see that. Now, I am receiving other questions as well. So I'll get to those other questions in just a moment. This is an Ask an Imam, a live session, a live broadcast linked with the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. That is www.alislam.org. This is a live session, and you are free and welcome to ask me questions. Either if you are on Twitter, you can just type it in to the stream, or if you are on YouTube, you can submit the questions through the live chat. And if you are on Facebook, you can use the comment section. If there is someone on Facebook who is watching this, if you can just say salam or type in anything just to confirm that you are watching and you are able to watch, everything is okay. It's always good to have the confirmation. On my end, everything looks okay, but it's always good to have a confirmation from your end as well, so that there is no confusion. And you know, so that I can know for sure that the stream is working fine. Now, the other question, the other clarification I wanted to make was that there was some discussion, maybe it was yesterday or the day before, about a profession of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. I do not recall the exact point when this was discussed, but I would like to clear it up anyways. And that was in regard to the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, becoming a lawyer. He never became a lawyer. So if I said that if the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, became a lawyer, that was not correct. I don't recall having said something like this, but if I did, then it is not correct. The promised Messiah, peace be upon him, never actually became a lawyer. What happened was, and I'm just, as I talk to you, I am opening up the reference. I had it open earlier, but I accidentally did not set it up at the beginning of this stream. The profession that I was referring to was in Sialkot. And the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, actually did write an exam to become a lawyer, but he did not pass. And so that did not actually happen, that he never actually had the profession of law. What happened is that he did become a reader in Sialkot court. So he was in Sialkot for some time in his life. And this is discussed in, and let me show you as I talk about this. This is discussed in this book, Life of Ahmad. If you want this book, you can go to alislam.org and you can download this. It's on alislam.org. Just type in Life of Ahmad in the search bar and this book will show up. This is in the section on his early life. So Mirza Ghulam Murtaza Sahib thought of securing a government post for Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam, his son. In 1863, he got him appointed as a reader in the Sialkot court. Though he did not like the work, but it was necessary that he should have the experience. So he went there and it was by divine will, he was able to see the worldly nature of this profession, and he went through that life, which made him more experienced in this regard. So we know that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also, for a short period of time, he went into trade, and he became part of those trade caravans. These kind of things happen with the prophets of Allah, so that they are basically able to experience that world, and they can advise their communities better later on in life when they are appointed by Allah as prophets. So in this case as well, the same happened, that the promised Messiah alayhi salam had no real interest in these worldly jobs, but because of his father appointing him in that position, he took up that job and was there in Sialkot for some period of time. This is discussed here. I'm not going to go all in all the details, but it's on page 47 of Life of Ahmad. If you want, again, you can download this book, Life of Ahmad, from alislam.org. Just type it in the search bar. And on page 47, there is some discussion of this topic. And if I made some error in my recent stream, this should clear it up now, that there is, you know, he never actually became a lawyer. He did try one of the exams, but he did not pass that exam, and so he abandoned that pursuit altogether. All right. Do we have, one question is, do we have our angels with us after we pass away? Allah knows best. You know, when it comes to matters of the afterlife, much of it is not directly understandable for us, right? There is some academic discussion about the afterlife in the Quran and in the Ahadith and in the writings of the Promised Messiah Islam. And if you want to know more about it, I recommend this book, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, that is available on alislam.org, and might as well take a moment to show you. If you are on alislam.org, just type in the search bar, Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, and the book will show up, Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. And in this book, there is a detailed discussion of life after death. Life after death is thoroughly discussed. Now, at the same time, we should remember that the Quran is clear that no one knows precisely about the nature of the afterlife. There is some discussion to give us some idea, but no one knows about the pleasures that are in store for those who are believers, who go in heaven after they die. But there is some discussion of it. There is an academic discussion of it. So we get an idea of what it would be like and the stages that a person would go through. As you can see in here, in this introduction to this book, the subjects include the physical, moral, and spiritual states of man, proofs of the existence of God, the state of man after death, sources of divine knowledge, and others. So it's an excellent introduction to the study of Islam. It's available in multiple formats, including audiobook, and I strongly recommend that you check it out. Specific to your question, Allah knows best that those angels who are appointed for our accountability, what happens to them after we die. Okay, next question. Some members have said, Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. One person has asked, since I am working at night and I stay up at nights, can I offer nawafil as tahajjud, or does tahajjud require sleep before prayer? So tahajjud does require that we sleep, and that is the sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there has to be some amount of sleep before we can offer tahajjud. In your case, yes, you can offer nawafil. No one is stopping you from offering nawafil. But the specific tahajjud prayer, it requires a little bit of sleep. before you can, even if it's a very small, short nap, but it is required. Because that effort has to be there, right? That we are, you know, we go to bed and then we wake up specifically for the Nafl prayer. That effort has to be there if we want to fully benefit from Tahajjud prayer. And that question was from YouTube. Now I'm going to go to Twitter. I'm getting a question about Khalid bin Sinan. I have been asked this question before. I don't know much about Khalid bin Sinan. If you want to do some research, you can do some research, but I have not heard much about him in Islamic literature. Allah knows best. Second question from the same person on YouTube is that in Witr prayer, when to recite Dua-e Kunut? After ruku or before ruku? Can you please share a reference? I have seen in our Jamaat that we are always offering it after, we're always reciting it after ruku in Qiyam. And this is the norm I've seen in all our mosques. So that is a process we should follow. And we have our Khulafa who have guided us. And this is the method that they have approved as well. But at the same time, when it comes to Dua-e Kunut, you should remember that it is not an essential part of the prayer. It is a prayer. It is a beautiful prayer. But it is not absolutely necessary to offer it in our Witr prayer. Even if we do not recite it, it does not directly impact the Witr prayer itself. It is not an absolute portion without which there is no Witr prayer. No, it's a prayer, an additional prayer that is offered. And even if it's not offered, if we forgot to offer it, that is fine. And if we are offering or reciting Dua-e Kunut before Ruku, that is also fine. But I have seen that in our Jamaat, the norm is to do it after Ruku, and that's the norm that we should be following. Previously, and this is a question that previously you mentioned at the time of Prophet Moses, who there was a person who lost his way just because Allah made Moses a prophet. Can you share his name or reference? His name I did mention at that time as well. I actually showed from the Holy Quran the details about him. Balam Baur is the name. I'm not sure, but I think he's referred to Balaam as Balaam, either in the Bible or in Jewish traditions. Now, as far as the Holy Quran goes, we can certainly go to alislam.org, and we can certainly see if that is available or not. Let me see why my Al-Islam is not showing up here. Okay, so let me take you there, alislam.org. Okay, there we go. It's showing up now. I'm going to go ahead and see if the words Rafa'a can be searched here, and if those words can be searched here, and then I will remember the verse that specifically applies to this person. Okay, so I'm going to go through here, and as you can see, I use the Arabic search, and I can go through the verses of the Holy Quran that mention this. Rafa'nahu is one of those words. Let me see if I can find this. Please bear with me here. You know, but even if I can't find it, then at least you have seen the process in which I'm going through. And that is the same process that you can use to look for these kinds of references. Right here. So in chapter 7, verse 177, as you just noticed that I clicked on the top left where the verse number is so that I can go to the actual verse, and that will open up the other options like the detailed English 5-volume commentary. It says, "And if he had pleased, we could have exalted him thereby, but he inclined to the earth and followed his evil inclination." And let's see if this is mentioned in the commentary here. So they don't directly mention the person. They don't directly mention this, but it is in our Urdu commentaries. So what you can do is then you can go to the Urdu Tafasir. So if you go into the Urdu Tafasir, then you can find more details about him. So try to do this search, and if it still doesn't work out for you, do let me know so that I can help you out more. But right now I have to move on to other questions. I have a lot of other questions here. But this is a process that you can, I just showed you, you can go through the same process and find this person who is mentioned. Hopefully you know how to read Urdu, because in Urdu literature you can find more details about him. Why is Sunnah, that's the next question, this is from Twitter, why is Sunnah more reliable than Ahadith? That is because Sunnah is something that we are getting through directly from the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So let's take the example of Salat. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered Salat, that was his Sunnah, Fajr, Zuhr, Asr, Maghrib and Isha, the five daily prayers. And he offered it, you know, we know that there are this many rakat in Fajr and this many in Asr and this many in other prayers. So those rak'at and all those things were taught to his companions. His companions taught it to the next generation. The next generation taught it to the next generation. The next generation taught it to the next generation. Until our parents, for those of us who have Muslim parents, our parents were taught those same sunnah, the same traditions, and we are employing those in our day-to-day lives. That is sunnah. It has a direct link all the way to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, direct link of passing on the traditions from parents to children, from community to the next generation, right? Now, when it comes to ahadith, the ahadith were not written down during the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were not written down even in the few decades right after him. It took 150 to 200 years before the ahadith started to be written down, and even in that process they came to realize there are a lot of narrations going around which are not authentic. So we have Imam Bukhari, who had a very strict criteria, and he put the ahadith, he filtered them through that criteria, and he only collected in his collection, Sahih Bukhari, he only collected those narrations regarding which he was quite sure that they have to be authentic, because they pass through that really strict criteria. I'll talk to about the criteria some other time, but it gives you an idea that because these ahadith and narrations were collected many, many years later, they are not at the same level. I don't want to use the word reliable, because sunnah has a higher level, you can say, and ahadith have a lower level. And there are many, many ahadiths that relate to, that were narrated by only one individual. There are ahadiths and narrations that are narrated by very few people. Or there might be some ahadiths that do not seem to be in harmony with the other ahadiths or with the Quran. So the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, has given us a very clear criteria here. He has said that we put the Quran first, because regarding that there is absolutely no doubt. It's from Allah, it's perfectly preserved, and it has come down to us in its perfect form. And if the hadith seems to be contradicting the Quran, then we try to make an interpretation of it which aligns it with the Quran. But if the interpretation, if we are not able to align it, then we do not accept such hadith, right? So the Quran is the judge. If the Quran says something and the hadith supports it, then that hadith is authentic. And if the hadith contradicts it and we are able to align some of its meanings to the Quran, then that hadith can be accepted with those meanings. But if there is no way to interpret it in a way that aligns it with the Quran, then we do not accept that hadith. This is discussed in one of the books of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him. Let me head on over to the alislam.org website and see if I can somehow quickly show you the place where this is discussed. So on alislam.org, if you go on alislam.org and click on Promised Messiah at the very top here, Promised Messiah. So underneath, if you scroll down, you have all these books of the Promised Messiah, and there we go. So I searched for the term debate on this page. So this is the book that I was looking for, a review of the debate between Batalvi and Chakralvi. This is a book available in English in multiple formats that covers this topic. So if you are interested in learning more on this topic, this is the book that I strongly, strongly recommend you read so that you have a better understanding of this subject matter. Okay. Many others have said salam. I really appreciate you joining. One person has asked, is music forbidden in Islam? Music per se is not forbidden. It depends on the kind of music it is. When it comes to these kind of issues, I remember, and I'll share the reference as well, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the IV, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, has talked about this. He's talked about how music is more into the gray areas. You know, in fiqh, we have some issues that are absolute halal, and there are some things that are absolutely haram. But then there are other things that lie in between. So music is one of those things. Now, it's 50-50. If a certain kind of music is taking us away from Allah, then that will become forbidden for us. But if that music is not impacting us, then it falls back into the gray area, neither good nor bad. And if the music is becoming an obsession, if it's taking up too much of our time, if it's distracting us, if it's taking us in the wrong direction, then that is obviously not going to be encouraged. So I suggest, again, going to alislam.org, and you can either in the search bar just type in the word music, and you will find what are the Islamic teachings regarding art and music. So you'll find this resource, for instance, and this will give you some answer. The detailed answer by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed is also given here. So you can read through that detailed answer, or I believe if you click on his name, they might have more resources available. Okay, no. So this page is about Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed, Rahimahullah Ta'ala. So it's not giving a detail, but this is a detailed answer. You can go through this answer. Similarly, permissibility of music in Islam. Are Muslims allowed to listen to this music? What is the healing power of music? All these things are available on alislam.org. Similarly, we have these question and answer sessions where, for instance, we have this question and answer session from 26 November 1994. And on this page, you have, it says music. So on 5424, music industry and TV channels have a huge influence, and music is used for therapy as well. What is our policy on music is discussed here. So all these things are very easily available for you. And this is something, hopefully, that clarifies this topic for you. Tawfiq Ahmed has asked, why was Islam the first religion to ban slavery? We don't know. Slavery is not a teaching that comes from God. It is a teaching, it's a human innovation. So I don't know where the origins of slavery were, but I'm pretty sure that whenever prophets of Allah came, they condemned these kind of practices. The only thing is that other than the Holy Quran, there is no holy book in the world that has experienced perfect preservation. So there's no other holy book or holy scripture in the history of mankind, in the history of humankind that is as preserved, as well preserved as the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran obviously gives us the teachings to on how to end slavery. The Holy Quran talks about that. But the other religious books out there, they don't have such, we don't have the clear picture of what their position was on slavery. Especially when it comes to the Bible. In fact, there are places in the Bible where there is an endorsement of slavery. So this has to be something that is to be explained by Christians or Jews regarding this, especially Christians, because some of the Christian portions of the Bible are very strong on this. So was that a later interpolation? Was that a later addition into those books? We don't know, because we don't have the perfectly preserved original writings and words of the prophets. The Bible has these words written down for such some prophets, hundreds of years afterwards, 500, 600, 700 years after those prophets passed away, then those things were written down. So God knows best what was the situation and whether or not they condemned slavery. We do know that Moses, for instance, who came 3,000 years ago, more than 3,000 years ago, he took the Israelites out of slavery. So he was actually bringing an end to the slavery of his people. So, those things have been going on from that time. Now, Islam is very clear on it. Islam has a holy book that was perfectly preserved. And that's why we know that Islam is very clear. And it has given us the teachings to bring an end to slavery. Why not anyone before it? So yeah, I hope I've answered this question for you. Suhaib has asked, could you briefly discuss the person of Khizr mentioned in the Quran? What is the Jamaat's perspective on it? Whenever I get a question related to the Quran, I take the opportunity to show you how you can very easily search in the Quran on alislam.org. There's a feature here. Let me try first the word Khizr and see if it will show up or not. So this one hasn't appeared. So maybe the spellings were not correct. Okay, no. So this word has not appeared in this way. Let me try the Arabic. I know it's in Surah Al-Kahf and I can find it that way also. But just to try and show you also how this is done. So you type in Khizr. And let's see. No, this is not a direct reference. Khizr, actually, the person that you are talking about is not directly mentioned in the Holy Quran. I was just checking if the commentary search will also be part of this Quran search, but it is actually not going into the commentary search. So that doesn't directly answer our question. So let me show you. What you can do then instead is that go to the Quran general page where we have all these verses, surahs of the Holy Quran. Go to Suratul Kahf. Suratul Kahf, if you go in chapter 18 of the Holy Quran and scroll down either or search the verses in between where the mention of Khizr comes and look into the commentary of those verses, especially this 5-volume commentary that I've already enabled on my browser here. And you can enable it by clicking on the gear icon at the top right here, and it'll give you these options. Make sure that the 5-volume commentary option is selected. So once you have that, you can, then go into the commentary of those verses and you will have an understanding. Broadly speaking, this incident that is discussed in this portion of the Holy Quran regarding Khizr and his meeting with Hazrat Musa, Prophet Moses alayhi salam, we understand that to be a mirage, part of a spiritual experience of Moses. So Sufia talk about the mirage of all the saints, a special spiritual experience, a very unique spiritual vision that saints of God have. And Moses had that, and similarly Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had that, in fact multiple times by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when it comes to Moses, this was part of that vision, that really eloquent, or you can say clear vision that God had showed him. This is a vision in which he saw these things, and if you look into the five volume commentary, this will be very clear for you, and you can get all the details from there. Because it's a very broad subject, I don't know where to start this, especially not having all the verses in front of you right away. But I've checked already 23 verses, and this discussion hasn't started yet. So you can go on your browser and you can scroll down and read up. Like I said, if you want to read the commentary, I've showed before as well, click on the number of that verse and it will pop up. The commentary will pop out and you can just read the commentary here. So for all these verses, you can do that. Just click on the number here and the commentary will come and you can understand it. Right now, the discussion in Surah Al-Kahf in the beginning is about the Ashab-e-Kahf, the people of the cave. Those are being discussed here. But later on, this discussion about Khizr also appears. Check it out from here. And if there are any further questions, I would be more than happy to help you find those answers. One person has asked that if there is a specific time that this program starts. This program, as far as I'm concerned, I do it normally at this time. In fact, a little earlier than this time. Today, I got delayed by almost an hour. Usually an earlier. So I don't know which country you are in. An hour before I started today. So right now, it's in the Eastern time zone. It's almost 6 p.m. I usually try to be online at 4:30 p.m. Eastern, but my colleagues, Fatir, Ataul Fatir Sahib and Azam Akram Sahib also come on a daily basis. So if you're in a country where a different time zone would suit you better, you can follow their programs as well. They are also coming on a daily basis for these live streams. As far as I'm concerned, I'm usually on here around 4:30 p.m. Eastern time, so you can calculate whatever time that applies to you. And if we would love for other people to benefit from these kind of programs. I also want to take a moment here to ask you for any feedback. Today's session, I started with two clarifications because I get feedback and sometimes people correct any mistake I have made. So I would love to have that. If you want to reach out to us, you can reach out through our email, which is askanimam@alislam.org. That is askanimam, one word, @alislam.org. You can reach out to us, and especially if there's any feedback, there's something that I said that is not correct, that you read something differently in some Jamaat literature, feel free to send it to us so that we can correct ourselves. We do these sessions on a regular basis. They are available on YouTube. They are available on Twitter and other and Facebook as well. Next question is that one person has appreciated that I've answered my question and their question in a previous live stream. I appreciate it, brother or sister. Please do remember me and my colleagues in your prayers who are making this program possible for you. What is meant by Hur? This word can be searched for in the Holy Quran, and this is one of the last questions I'm going to take today, and because my stream is now coming to an end. So if you go to alislam.org, you can go to the homepage here, and on the very bottom here, you can click on the Quran section and then click on Go. And from Go, you can then type in, I've forgotten the question that was asked, okay, about Hurs. So click on the Al-Arabiya and type in Arabic if you know, or you can, even if you don't know Arabic, you can experiment. The alphabet is here and you can see the alphabet, and you can, right here, the word Hur has been used. Fair maidens. So the commentary is not going to show up here, so I have to click on the actual verse, and then I can go into the five-volume commentary. You can see that they haven't discussed the word here. Maybe it has appeared in some other part of the Quran first, and that's where the word has been used. I do know what it means, that it means fair maidens, but I'm trying to show you that whenever you have a question like this, this is the way to go, that you can easily find this, you know, and it's very easy to search for these terms. So I'm going to go through a surah and verse which is where this is word comes earlier. So chapter 44, verse 55, maybe that's where they might have an important discussion right here. So they have a discussion of the word hur. So they say, according to the commentary, it says, fair maidens is a plural of hura, which is derived from hara. He washed the cloth, he made it white, whiteness of the white of the eye, and blackness of the black, essentially referring to the beauty of the being who will be in paradise, and the believers will have these maidens when they go to heaven. But the word hur is actually gender neutral. So in a lot of our translations, we'll say that they are fair maidens, and it's obviously an implication of that they are feminine. But the word hur is actually applies to anyone. When it comes to it doesn't have a specific gender. So whether the believers are men or women, they will have hoors. And the idea is the word zavvajnahum implies that they will have a relationship. So the idea is that this relationship would be present in heaven as well. In heaven, they will be, you know, the souls will be paired so that they can support one another, right? Their relationship would be such that it will be beautiful, it will be comforting, and they will be spiritually uplifting for each of them. So this duality, concept of duality, exists in heaven. Whether a male goes into heaven or a female goes into heaven, that duality will be there in heaven as well. Of course, the actual nature of heaven, as we have talked about earlier as well, is not known to us. We don't know the kind of pleasures we will have in paradise, and that's an unknown world. And the hadith also says that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, right? What kind of pleasures will be there in heaven? So what does this mean? This is just to give us an idea. And it means that there will be a duality, there will be relationship, or there will be the souls will be brought together in such a way that they can complement one another. Is this email for all three of you? The email that I just announced? Yes, the email that I just announced is for all three of us. askanimam@alislam.org. Is it possible for a mu'min to suffer from depression? Of course it is. Depression does not specify itself to any religion, any specific religion. It does not apply. It can affect anyone from any background, any cultural background, any religion, and we should try to find the ways to combat it. Now, a lot of times when religious people talk about it, they will just say, turn to prayer. And I'm also going to say that because the Quran says that in the remembrance of Allah, there is comfort of the hearts. That is there. But of course, there is certain kinds of depression which need some medical attention. There are other kinds of depression that may need some therapy or some other kind of behavior change or something. And there's still other kinds of depression that affect everyone. Anyone can have that, and there are ways and means to avoid that. For instance, changing your environment, changing your friends, changing the way your life is set up, improving your habits, daily habits, those kind of things that can help combat depression. So it depends on a case-by-case person. I can't give one answer that would be a solution for everyone. There are some people who have a severe kind of depression for whom they might have to go to the doctors and maybe even get some medicine for it. And there are others who don't need the medicine, who just need a behavior change, who might be missing motivation in their lives. So it depends, right? It depends. I'm not an expert on these things, but I have read a few things, and that's what I'm sharing with you. And on alislam.org as well, you can type in depression and some resources will be available for you to study. The last question, again, I know I've already taken another question after my last question. The question, but I've briefly addressed this, is how was the Bible and Torah compiled? This is a big question. So a very quick answer would be that the Bible was written down centuries afterwards. So for instance, Prophet Isaiah came. He might have written a few things here and there, but those things were collected much, much later, a few centuries later, and they were written down. And a lot of it was also orally transferred from one person to another. And some others started writing these things down. So approximately 300, 400, 500 years before the coming of Jesus Christ, things started to be written down. And we have the earliest portions of the Bible available through the Dead Sea Scrolls that were found 100 to 150 years, like their dating is from 150 years before Jesus. That's the earliest Bible in written form that we have. It's in the Dead Sea Scrolls. If you search up or read up on the Dead Sea Scrolls, the earliest portions of the Bible are available from that period, and written in that time, all the way up to the time of Jesus Christ. And after Jesus Christ came, some of his followers also wrote down those things that he said, and they were written down in the Gospels. But the Gospels again were written 25, 30, 35, 40, 50 years, 70 years after the crucifixion of Jesus, whether it was a crucifixion or from our perspective, it was his migration from Palestine all the way to India. So in either case, he wasn't present when the Gospels were actually written, and they were written in a language that Jesus did not speak. So this is a very brief introduction, but it's a longer subject. You can search up more on it and get more details. But that's all I'm going to say for now. Maybe in a future live stream, I can start with this discussion and go into some more details. Jazakumullah to all of you who joined us today. It was a real pleasure. Please remember me and my colleagues in your prayers. All the brothers of the volunteers, all the brothers and sisters who are working with alislam.org, please remember them in your prayers. Jazakumullah and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.